You are listening to The Future of Work, Water Cooler Conversations, where business leaders share how they integrate humanity and technology to create a better workplace for today and tomorrow. This radio show and podcast is brought to you by Max 6 Entrepreneurial Center. And now let's listen in as Jen Burrell and Kyle McIntosh connect with today's valued guests.
And we're back with the Future of Work Water Cooler Conversations. I'm Kyle McIntosh, as always, discussing our fascination with business leaders who have developed innovative approaches, healthy cultures, flexible workspaces, and seamless virtual technology. Today, we're switching up the show a little bit, and I'm excited to introduce you to my co-host for this show, Scott McIntosh, who is my father and business partner. And we will be speaking today with Brian Burns and Sherman Chu, both managing partners and co-founders of GrayHawk Capital, a venture capital business investing in businesses in the Southwest United States. Welcome to the show, all three of you.
Thank you.
So first question, and let's go around the table this way for this question. I'd like to ask you as well, but where did you grow up and how did you get from there to where you sit today? And it's less of a business question and more of just a, hey, we're four people sitting in this room. I'm curious.
Well, for me, that could be a long story. I've jumped around a little bit. Born on the East Coast, Massachusetts, actually. Moved to California at the age of four, where I lived for 11 years in the Bay Area. Halfway through high school, my dad uprooted us. Moved to Tucson because he was working for IBM at the time and got transferred with a promotion there to the shiny new facility. So finished high school there, went to a college at University of Arizona with my degree in marketing. Moved overseas for about a year, Taiwan specifically, to get some work experience. And then applied to some different graduate schools, went to Texas A&M for my MBA. So, and I ended up living in Texas for the next 8.5 years. After graduate school, I went to work for Bank One in their Dallas office for the next 6.5 years. And then 95 is when I came back to Arizona to help manage our first fund called Cornerstone. And I've been back to, I've been here in Arizona ever since and enjoying it, obviously.
Great. Yeah. Great. What about you,
Ryan? I actually grew up in Iowa, small town in Iowa. Although it's grown quite a bit since I was there, a town called Ankeny. And after high school, you know, good Iowan, I went to Iowa State University in Ames, Iowa. And strangely, after a couple years there, I went on a spring break to visit a couple of frat brothers who had moved out to ASU. And when I came out, it was a freak snowstorm in Iowa for spring break week. We got about 36 inches. I hopped in the Delta 88 with a couple other guys. We came out here to Tempe. You know, of course, spring baseball was going on. Everybody was hanging out at the fountain. So then I went back and had to convince my folks that it was all about the academic opportunity of moving to ASU. Fortunately, they were saints. They supported me in everything I did. I moved out to Arizona to go to ASU in 79, ended up graduating in 81. Went to work for Arthur Anderson, the CPA firm, who was the largest in Phoenix at the time, for about 8 years, then got into the investment business and met Sherman, and we became partners in the late 90s.
Exciting.
Scott here, and I kind of co-host sitting in for Jennifer, and also it was originally planned. I'm kind of a guest, as I'm just excited, Sherman and Brian, and to have you guys in GrayHawk Capital. I've known of GrayHawk Capital for many, many years and recently became an investor. And so just excited for this possibility that we're able to do this. I've told my story so many times in so many ways, but I was born in Seattle, grew up in New York and high school in Ohio, and then came out to Arizona. I'm a Wildcat as well. Sorry for all you Sun Devil fans. I'm married to a Sun Devil, so it's mixed, but it became an engineer somehow. I fought my way through and I had a career in mining and worked in deep underground mining all of my my career. There wasn't much of any of that in Arizona. It was Colorado. It was Idaho. It was the Philippines and Canada. And 1993, jumped off an entrepreneurial cliff, April Fool's Day, 93, and bought a business. And Kyle was, how old were you in 93?
9, 10
years old.
9 or 10.
Yeah. And so young family and 10 years of survival, 5 years of rock and roll. And that was a big success that allows me to sit here today and Kyle and I got together working, and Mac 6 came out of that. And now we're doing some different, some very different things. So just happy to be here with everybody.
Thank you. So before we get into more detailed questions and what we want to talk about, I think it would help for anybody listening. Could you guys describe GrayHawk Capital in broad strokes? And what is it that you guys do as a business?
Yeah, absolutely. So we're a venture capital firm, really investing in early growth stage software companies throughout Western U.S. We tend to lead more of those, you know, in our backyard here in the Southwest, but we do invest anywhere in the continental U.S. We're generally writing checks of anywhere from $1 to $5 million in these companies. Then we participate at the board level to help these companies grow and reach a good exit at some point. We're generally in our funds. We have to raise funds every so many years. They're blind pools, and the funds we've had have been 60 to 70 million in size, from which we deploy into 15 or 16 companies within each fund.
At this point, you know, Sherman and I have been doing this together along with our other partners, Brian and Lee, for quite a while. And we have some, you know, fairly specific criteria that we're looking for in these companies. So we probably end up looking at over 100 opportunities for every one that we end up investing in, something like that. So, you know, it's kind of a matching process. And that doesn't mean the other 99 are not great companies. It just means for whatever reason, they don't fit sort of the criteria that we've kind of set for ourselves over 25 years of making mistakes in investing in order to continue to refine the process.
You know, Sherman, as you, Scott here, as you said, we're early stage. I mean, it's there's a broad spectrum of what early stage is. As we at Mac 6 here, we've got a lot of solopreneurs who are starting something, and then we're involved in the angel investment world, and you're in many respects much later stage than that. But I mean, where do you see yourselves fitting that ecosystem of from startups through and where you are, and maybe where companies go as they exit from GrayHawk?
Yeah, absolutely. So you're right. A company goes through its life, as a company goes through its life cycle, it'll raise capital from different sources, different categories of capital providers. We are usually what they call Series A, which means we're usually the first institutional investor that comes in after perhaps the angel stage. And then prior to the angel stage, it's usually, you know, family and friends to get these companies off the ground. And then following that, well, and let me be more specific. These are companies, when I say Series A, they have a product in the market usually and are generating revenues. Yep. And our specific criteria is more kind of 2 to 5 million in annual recurring revenues. Yep. And then, of course, thereafter, we do hold dry powder to support the companies in subsequent rounds, Series B, Series C, et cetera. But there are, you start moving into the territory of other types of later stage funds that you alluded to, Scott, that will come into those rounds as well. You know, our exit, you are asking a little bit about exits.
Well, yeah, and where, if the company is still raising capital, and is there a point at which they may have outgrown GrayHawk or venture capital?
We hope so.
Does it go public then, or is there private equity, or are there other sort of groups that just that whole series that companies may go through?
Oh, absolutely. We tend to favor capital-efficient business models. Having said that, though, you know, the round sizes have grown over time. These companies do need, in a Series A round, anywhere from 5 to 10 million to have a proper runway, you know, achieve the milestones they want to. As they continue to progress, they will need additional rounds of capital, you know, beyond us. We will support the companies, usually maybe 2-3 rounds, and likely a declining amount. And then thereafter, what they'll need to do is really go out to raise money from later stage funds that could come in with bigger checks.
Yeah.
And then ultimately, you know, there are different forms of, I guess there's different ways that can go as they continue to raise capital. Maybe we no longer participate, you know, in these larger later stage rounds. And ultimately, it may be an exit for us as well. We're starting to see more and more secondary type transactions where these large investors come in, they run right big checks, company doesn't want to take the dilution, so they allow them to write a smaller check for the growth capital, perhaps, and then a second check to take existing shareholders, investors out. Typically, you know, we're looking for an M&A transaction for our exit at some point down the road. Okay. You can't always control that. You know, there's market conditions and those sort of things. But we are seeing secondaries as a very active market and becoming, you know, certainly entering the mix for us as partial liquidity and or full exit.
Okay.
So question on the other side of it. That's what ideally happens at the end. M&A, we graduate this company out of the working with you guys and onto the next level. But how does it look in the beginning? If I'm an entrepreneur, I'm doing $4 or $5 million a year right now, I've got a high growth opportunity. How do I know that this is something I could be looking at and makes sense for my business? I mean, hey, raising funds and getting extra cash sounds good, but it's not always the right answer for every business.
Absolutely. You know, certainly, you know, you could have a very successful lifestyle business as a sole proprietor, right? When you take on capital, you have to be prepared for, you know, a very long-term relationship with your investment partners, and you're going to take dilution, right? So, and then control, those two things, you know, valuation, control are the two most sensitive areas for any entrepreneur. I think the things they need to consider would be, one, is this capital provider the right partner for me? You got to make sure there's the right chemistry. Again, you'll be working together for a very long time. But even before that, I think the company needs to decide whether it is one that has that kind of opportunity that, you know, because the dilution, you have to overcome the dilution you're taking for much greater value at the end of the rainbow, right? So there has to be that opportunity there that's worth pursuing. Otherwise, you know, you could very well keep 100% of a smaller pie and do very well.
And, you know, you mentioned capital efficiency, which I think is sort of important to GrayHawk, given that, you know, we're not in Silicon Valley. As a matter of fact, we're mostly investing in what would be considered to be underserved venture capital markets. So in those markets, you know, unlike, again, Silicon Valley or maybe the Northeast, we don't have billion-dollar funds. So the check sizes that the funds can write, and we almost always participate in a syndicate, are smaller checks. So in order to make the same progress, we're looking for those companies to do it, but hopefully on less resources, which benefits everybody. Say, if you can exit a company for $200 million and it took $20 million, that's much better than the company that exits for $300 million that took $50 million. And you guys understand, I know you guys understand the math on that.
So understand the math, but say more about that underserved market, what that means compared to Silicon Valley. And I'm really curious where GrayHawk fits in this, compare, contrast Silicon Valley and what that underserved market really is.
You know, I think, Scott, in those markets, those underserved markets, we're typically, funds like ours are typically a better fit than those Silicon Valley funds, because we can deploy checks of $2 or $3 million. You know, if you're a billion-dollar fund, it's hard to do anything less than $20 million at a time. The kind of software and SaaS companies that we're looking at in our market don't really need $20 million, nor would it necessarily be advantageous for them to take $20 million at this point.
So it's kind of a related question, but I've met you guys, I've talked with you guys, and I'm still kind of learning here. But there's valuation, there's control, the two things, Sherman, you mentioned. Then you also mentioned chemistry. As we talk with younger entrepreneurs, and too often they think money's all the same. I just need money. I say, no, money is not all the same, and you really need to find somebody who really understands you. And so that word chemistry, as you talk about the word chemistry, what does that mean to you as you look at an investment?
Well, that means getting to know each other, frankly, at a personal level. And a lot of the companies we do invest in, we actually have known the founder CEOs for maybe a couple of years or more. So it's about establishing that rapport and relationship during that time, just to make sure, I mean, you're comfortable working with each other.
Right.
So that, I think that's kind of what I'm speaking to on chemistry. You know, a lot of these companies we invested in, they were frankly too early when they first came to us. But we do, you know, stay on top of their progress and get to know management during that time frame.
And, you know, I think we look at it, you know, just the opposite, the flip side of the coin that you're talking about from a Greyhawk standpoint. If we don't think we can provide anything other than capital or a check, it's not a good investment opportunity for us.
So let's stay on this chemistry thing for a minute here, because I think what we're alluding to is this mad search for money that a lot of entrepreneurs seem to be on. And it's all about, if I had that money, I could do this. And it's just any way I could find it, that's what I'm going after. And what we're talking about here is the chemistry between the investor and the CEO, the team, mm-hmm. the group. How much time do you guys spend, though, on the culture that's there in the company, the chemistry that's there with that team? You're investing money into this tech SaaS company, but how much of it is about the people in that business?
Well, people's always an important ingredient to any successful investment. It's kind of three main blocks, and there's subcategories, but it's going to be management, product, and market, right, for us that we're broadly evaluating. In terms of the culture, you know, I guess, yeah, we do in our due diligence process spend time with management as well as even before, again, we move on to evaluating investment. The culture itself, I guess, should have proven itself at that point in time, because we are looking at the financial traction, but there is still going to be, and the success they've had up to that point, right? We want to see some momentum. We want to see the dogs eating the dog food, as they say. But there's still a lot of unknowns, because at that point in time, the team is still quite small, and you have to fill in the gaps and expand that team as you grow and scale, which is what you want to see, but there's always going to be that risk as you start doing that.
People are the great opportunity, and most of the time, the issues as well.
Yeah.
You know, we should probably make it clear, too, from a Greyhawk standpoint, you know, we're involved in helping set the direction of these companies, the overall strategy, you know, the senior leadership. But we don't want to manage these companies on a day-to-day basis. We don't want to instill necessarily a culture in these companies. Yet, healthy cultures that seem to be successful for those companies, and it may be different types of cultures, we will support those and see how we can add to them.
As I said, you know, we do typically have board seats. About 80% of the time we have board seats. The other 20% of the time we have at least observation rights. And we do get involved, at least at the executive level. When I talk about expanding the team, like, we'll be involved with the interview process, as well as perhaps even referring some candidates from our own network to help the companies out.
Got another question related to exits and just some context around it. And our listeners can't see, but on the screen behind you, this is conscious capitalism. And there's, without going into too much about what that is, simplistically, it's about investing. It's about long-term versus short-term. And the simplistic analogy, Wall Street quarterly reporting causes executives to make decisions that are sometimes short-term focused. And short-term, if you're my employee, I pay you less money, I make more money, versus long-term thinking, if you're my employee, I can invest in you and your development and you become more productive and all those kind of things. At the angel investment level, I mean, any investor is looking for an exit. The problem with exits is it puts a short-term focus on things. And so this is something in conscious capitalism that I just continue. The best investments would be you invest forever. And there are venture funds and private equity that I'm invested in, Satori Capital, that invests with a 99-year time horizon. That doesn't mean exits don't happen. But I'm just curious, how do you look at that, where I think we all know it's easy to say long-term is better, yet as a venture capital fund, you've got a limited time frame at which you need exits. And how do you balance those things? And
yeah, good question. First, how do you define long term? We think 5 years is a pretty long term, but again, we can't control the exits. Unfortunately, for a fund like ours, we do have a finite life, you know, to these funds. So we do have to work towards exit within a reasonable amount of time. Yeah, you know, we model everything really kind of 5 years. We start getting a little antsy because of the time constraints imposed on funds. But there are ways to make it work with, and that's a conversation, frankly, we have to have with management teams up front, right? To understand their goals and make sure there's some alignment. But there are ways you could get around that, where if management wants to continue on, if it's an M&A, there are certainly opportunities for the company to continue to, if you have the right buyer, operate as a standalone and keep management in place. IPO, if the company goes public, IPO should not be looked at as just an exit strategy. It could be for investors, but from management standpoint, it's really just capital strategy. And so that's a situation where they'll continue on, right? If that is, you know, what they desire. So there are some different options like that.
Yeah, I think you're right in that our best exits generally, you know, the investors like us, we're gone. We've been bought out or we've taken our money, but the company whatever's made the company successful, which in software companies is usually the people, you know, they have the opportunity to go on with usually a much bigger acquirer who now has resources to help continue to develop, market the product. And depending on where your individual head's at, you know, do I want to be a corporate guy? Do I want to go back and start the next thing? I think it just creates potentially more opportunities.
Right. And I think you've both described what to me is the real answer as we talk about this in conscious capitalism, is having the conversations up front, that is, you take on an investor, there are certain tensions that are there, and knowing in advance in a 5-year time frame, here's what we need to be looking at. And then how do we manage those for the best success of GrayHawk as a fund and the investors and the managers in the company? And so it's just something to be managed through the relationship.
Yeah, absolutely.
One thing I'm curious about, we've talked about there's a different subset of investor class in Silicon Valley than elsewhere. Well, we're elsewhere in Arizona. What does that look like in Arizona? What does the ecosystem look like for venture capital, for fundraising, for entrepreneurship? Are we specializing in our own way? Are we finding different types of companies that really thrive because they're part of this ecosystem here? What does that look like?
We've seen, you know, we've been in this market a long time, so we've seen some different cycles. It does kind of come in waves, but broadly speaking, I would say it's still kind of early days for Arizona. To build it, fully build out an ecosystem takes time, and Silicon Valley has certainly done that very well. Here, you know, we had good activity in the late 90s, early 2000s, until the bubble bursted. Then the market receded. I think over the last 7-8 years, we've seen a lot of good effort from different kind of parts of the value chain, you know, come together to help build this ecosystem. You know, folks like ACA, Arizona Tech Council, the GPEC, et cetera. The ATI, right,
who's been very active. Desert Angels, what yeah. those groups are doing for
I think they all contribute to building this ecosystem. And then what we need to see are more success stories, you know, the LifeLocks, the 41st Parameters of the world with good exits. But thereafter, they really need to stick around, right, so that you could spin off. Well, one, you could keep that here locally and then spin off the talent, spin off the management talent, and the capital that could go all feed back into the ecosystem. And everything has to kind of be working at the same time. So sometimes it feels like a couple steps forward, a step back, but I think we're making good progress. We've been seeing a lot of good early stage activity these last 7-8 years. And I think it's just a matter of giving them some time. I think over the next 2 to 5 years, we'll see some good things come out of it, this market.
You listed a number of groups, the ACA, ATI, Desert Angels, these groups, Tech Council. How much of it is, it's great that we now have these resources in Arizona and more resources are better for these companies that are starting? And also, how much work, I guess, do you do with those groups? Do you collaborate with those groups or is it just a nice to have with more resources in one place?
No, one point there is that I think these resources have kind of come together and there's been better kind of collaboration between these resources from what we've seen over the last 2 decades. Because early days, it was a little more disparate in terms of the efforts. And sometimes people can step on, you know, each other's toes doing it. But I think there's a better collaboration today. We work with all of them. I mean, Scott could speak to his involvement at ATI. I mean, some of those deals coming out of ATI can be candidates for Greyhawk as they graduate.
We've been very involved in the ACA's Arizona Innovation Challenge granting over the years as an evaluator and as a judge. You know, been involved with a number of programs through ASU and worked pretty closely. You know, I actually agree with Sherman that the early stage support, including groups like MAC6, is probably as strong as I've seen it in 25 years in the Valley. Frankly, what's missing is that later stage groups like Greyhawk. As Sherman mentioned, there were once three or four at least groups like ours, similar size and interests in Arizona. You know, that's arguably one or two today, which means that in order to do an Arizona deal, which we still do, about 40% of our deals are Arizona deals, but in order to do an Arizona deal with syndicate partners, we typically have to import that capital from Colorado or Utah or somewhere, you know, regionally.
That syndication and something, as we kind of talked about, Arizona Tech Investors, which we've kind of been a partner for 10 years, is from 10 years ago when we were at ATI and Desert Angels in Tucson. As an entrepreneur at that earlier stage, they had to go to Desert Angels and they did their pitch and they did their due diligence. Then they went to ATI, they did their pitch, they did their due diligence. It was tough because, I mean, just you're on a road, and what's happened at the angel level is angel groups are now syndicating, and Desert Angels, ATI, and I think there's 20-some groups in the Southwest that are syndicating. And so I'm just interested, as you talk about that, is that that just creates more opportunity for flow. If it's a very early stage, an angel group by itself could invest in it. If it's a little bit later stage, angel groups can syndicate and then get up to the level where it may flow to a Greyhawk. But then you're also syndicating with others. And so my question of all that, where do your investors come from? And I'm a recent investor, and so I know where I came from. But as we look at Phoenix as a market, it's been so real estate dominated, and I think the real estate investment mindset is so different than what this is. I've had this mission to try and tickle a few more people from real estate in some way. But as we look at Arizona and investment, and what message might you send to others that might be interested in this thing, from the real estate mindset to others to be interested in this whole, it's that whole ecosystem, not just Greyhawk.
Scott, yeah, it's just, it sounds like you're asking about our investor base within the fund.
Your investor base, and then as you look to expand that through syndication, is
I'll start out, Sherman, and just unlike many markets, the bigger venture capital markets like a Silicon Valley, you know, Arizona really has no institutional investment as measured by some sort of state matching program or major pension funds in the state supporting venture capital, which we do see from time to time in some of the surrounding states. So our LPs by necessity really come from high net worth family offices, and a lot of those have been successful real estate investors who are looking for potentially some diversification opportunities.
Oh, yeah. They also include, executives or CEOs of private public companies, many of them from Arizona. This time around on Fund 3, 90% of our investors are from the Arizona community. So we've got kind of great support there that we're very pleased with.
What so this base of people that are participating in the funds, are they providing value other than monetary as well to help these companies? Is there much strategic work that goes back and forth?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I think one thing we're seeing this time around as well, I should have touched upon, is these executives, actually a lot of them have been coming out of the tech industry. So we certainly look forward to seeing more collaboration efforts with our own investors from standpoint of deal flow and or, you know, utilizing their skill sets within our portfolio, perhaps a board seat, executive chairman. Sometimes it's just assisting us with due diligence, you know, being able to look at the technology or a particular industry vertical. So we have and we will continue to tap into our investor base for those type of roles.
I think that's one thing that we think about and talk about the entrepreneur side all the time of You can't just look to follow the money. You've got to have this good strategic fit and this good culture fit or whatever it is with your financiers. But from the other perspective of being an investor, I mean, that's what makes this fun, right? Like that's the money side is great. Let's hope to grow this over time. But I get to work with a cool new company that's creating something of value for people that they, you know, hasn't ever been a part of this world before. Like that's what gets me excited every day. I mean, you guys have got to be like living this. Just it's got to feel great.
Kyle, it does beat public accounting in the, the excitement range. Yes.
It's been fun. It's been a fun journey.
It's 10 or so years ago when I had sold my business and what am I going to do? And this was about the same time you and I were getting together, Kyle, to start Mac 6. And somebody in California who I consider a friend and a mentor and said, hey, you ought to look at angel investing. It's very intellectually stimulating. Okay. Yeah. And so I, oh my gosh, yes, intellectually stimulating and emotionally stimulating, and it can be all kinds of things as you have your successes and your losses. But it's where I get my at Mac 6, where we have earlier stage companies, obviously, but we have real estate and desks and offices. That's a commodity. But what we're here for, what Kyle and I are both here for, is what we love is helping entrepreneurs grow their businesses. And that's not in the lease so much, but that's it's just a fascinating world to be in, to invest in, and to work with companies like this. So, yeah, it's you must really enjoy it.
You remember, Scott, when we were talking a few months back, you know, a little bit about your background. You know, Sherman and I and Greyhawk, we think it's important to understand, you know, a little bit about where our, you know, limited partners come from. And, you know, in your case, it just happened to be kind of a crazy coincidence that a week before I got a mining deal
in.
And, you know, gosh, mining, it looks kind of interesting, but who might know something about mining? You know, a week later we're talking and you go into your background, you know, and so it didn't end up leading, you know, to an investment yet, or it probably won't, but still, you know, it was so good to have someone. And, you know, we're fortunate, I would say, in a number of areas to have LPs, expert in a certain area. I'd say digital security being one of those areas where we have access to, you know, good expertise outside the fund.
Yeah, I remember that. That was fascinating. As people think about mining, whatever that was, but it's that particular company was a safety application, and that having
alertness, alertness.
Grown up in the mining industry, I mean, safety and for. Be careful what I say here, but safety is number one. And well, 1970, safety was number one until it came to production. And then, so safety really is. There's a culture of safety in the mining industry. And how do we? And so this app, this device, as I recall, had some kind of facial recognition to see how aware is somebody. And so you can do drug tests and alcohol tests. But there's something just fascinating to me where safety, whether it's mining or construction, as these technologies come along. What thing to do to evolve an industry.
So speaking of these companies that come along, what does a great company look like that is perfect for what would fit into the parameters of what you're looking for? And then are there a few cool companies you're working with right now that, hey, there's something really exciting that they have that watch out world, here it comes in the next few years?
Well, a strong company that fits our profile at that stage is one, like I said, maybe generating 2 to 5 million ARR, but they're showing, you know, pretty strong growth rate. At that stage, the company is kind of beyond, you know, R&D risk. They have a product in the market, obviously. The use of funds at that point in time will be primarily sales and marketing. On the management side, you know, we're looking for good leaders, obviously. They may be, and a lot of times they are first-time CEOs, but they've had good some experience as an executive within either a large Fortune 500 company and or earlier stage entrepreneurial companies as well in their background. The market they're going after should be big, and that's easy to say because we're talking about something in the future, you know, but they have to be kind of, they have to have like a $1 billion opportunity. Not that they're going to become necessarily a $1 billion revenue company. It's about optimizing your chances for success. So if you get 2%, 3% of a multi-billion dollar industry or market, you'll be very successful. So those, and then obviously on the product side, we're looking for a good, strong problem that they're solving. They should have barriers to entry, you know, some uniqueness to the product or complexity to the product and or IP. Software is a little harder to actually have patents. We see it once in a while, but we don't really rely on that per se. But we want to see at least they have a couple of years head start, you know, in the marketplace they're going after.
And what about that product side of it? Is there an industry that you guys specialize in, or is it all over the place?
Great question. We are generalists, really, at the end of the day. But some recurring themes across our funds have included fintech, cybersecurity, healthcare IT. And then more recently, we've been doing more in MarTech as well, at the end of Fund 2, going to Fund 3. And it's not like we predicted COVID-19, but I think post-COVID-19 marketing has become very, and digital marketing in particular, has become relevant.
And the decision to focus on software really kind of goes back to fund size and efficiency again. You know, we tend to stay away from opportunities that require a lot of working capital, lots of inventory, you know, fixtures and so on. You know, it's basically a couple guys with a whiteboard. Usually we're at the stage just after that, but you're mostly paying for smart people to develop good software at that point.
And we focus on the stage we do because we're really not in a position to just look at someone's technology and be able to evaluate, say, hey, that's great. You know,
that's not our background.
No, we do have people we could bring in to help look at the technology side of it. But really, again, at that point in time, they have customers. They are showing some financial traction. We could evaluate all those things that kind of speak to the product, right? And we will talk with customers in our due diligence to get feedback. Those tend to be very insightful.
So we all have just come out of a pandemic, or we're coming out of a pandemic, and lots of companies pivoted. And how did the Greyhawk invested companies manage? Were there many pivots, or how did they do coming through that?
You know, they were all affected in varying degrees. We have a telehealth company in our portfolio that got a significant, pardon the pun, shot in the arm. with COVID-19 and way surpassed their plan because of it. We have
another healthcare, but you know, that was a healthcare, but yet another healthcare opportunity because it focused on elective cardio procedures went the other way.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. But I think generally, you know, as you've heard Sherman and I say today, our portfolio, primarily SaaS softwares in industries, has always sort of focused on collaboration, remote use, efficiencies, and so on. So overall, I think we and our limited partners were very pleased at the way the portfolio came through the pandemic.
Yeah, the portfolio has come through it very well. In fact, is showing great performance today. I guess to cite a metric, you know, we look at TVPI, total value to paid in capital, and we're at about 5x on Fund 2, which we're very pleased with. You know, that essentially means if we sold everything today at the value the portfolio is at, we would return to investors about 5x their investment. But to illustrate another, again, the strength of digital marketing, we have a social media management company out of Southern California. Perform quite well. Their customers include bricks and mortar companies, folks like Anytime Fitness, Sports Clips Hair Salons. Company did not miss a beat through COVID-19. So it really illustrates the power of digital marketing and the relevance of digital marketing in today's environment. You know, but that's another example of a company
that's
done well.
We could have been focused on transportation or retail or hospitality, right. But fortunately, that's never been our focus, and you know, we consider ourselves very fortunate.
So another pandemic sort of related question as we're coming out. I mean, the world has changed, and as a show, it's the future of work, and part of that is, as all companies, Mac 6, we've got real estate, and people are coming back and putting their toes in the water, but it seems like there's going to be a hybrid model of work, and people working from home and not. And so kind of two parts of the question is What are you guys and your companies, like how many employees? Are they working from home? Are they working from an office? And are there any sort of innovations that you see coming through your invested companies that this whole future of work and where we're working is evolving?
Yeah, we have seen a lot of interesting things that were, I think, the result of COVID-19 collaborations. You mentioned we've seen some different things in that area, you know, like improvement upon the Zoom platform, perhaps. Well, we're looking at one now that's kind of a video platform built into short messages, which I think makes a lot of sense in the new work environment. We've seen a lot of, well, we've seen a lot more telehealth situations too recently. But healthcare is certainly ripe for innovation, disruption.
Yeah, and in general, with the type of companies we look at, you know, I mentioned a few minutes ago, at this point, they're primarily spending money on people. Probably the second biggest expense is space, right? Or it has been up to this point.
Right.
And as you guys know, you're real estate guys, you know better than this, but when we invest and the company is trying to enter into a lease and anticipate while they're growing like crazy what their needs are going to be in 5 years, they never get it right.
Right.
You know, and so we're either going to be scrambling for space or trying to sublease, you know, sometime during that period. In that way, moving more to remote and it has made our business a little easier in that we can, again, continue to focus on the people and not as much the space.
I think what's fascinating, and this is the conversation still going on, is we're seeing these much larger organizations that are saying, okay, well, we just figured out through technology that space just became a luxury. We don't have to have it, but now we can treat it as just a tool. If we need it for certain parts of our workforce, we know what we need, or we're figuring out what we need, but it doesn't have to be this sort of pervasive thought that was out there that everybody's got to be in the office in the same place with a big footprint. We just don't have to do that anymore. So it's an exciting time to see. Scary and exciting as we're in this market, but exciting to see what comes out of it. I think the answer is just more flexibility and people like us and Mac 6 and us are here for what do you need right now? Because who knows what the hell it's going to look like in a year, let alone 5 years. So let us help you grow and grow with you.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
What's fun is Mac 6. It's fun. It's scary, exciting. It's disruptive. And all of our customers right now are trying to figure out, do we need space or not? And we're a part of that conversation with them. And obviously, we have space to sell, but the key thing we're trying to sell now is flexibility and giving anybody, you know, I'm signing that five-year lease. And in some ways, we'd love to have a five-year lease, and it locks in, and we know what that is, but that may not be the solution.
But flexibility has probably never been more valuable than what it is today.
Right. Yeah. And that's if a company's growing or contracting, which can happen as well. And so that's, that was when I bought the first building that we have here, I was growing a company, and that's why I did it. It gave me flexibility to grow the company, and now that's what we're trying to do ourselves. It's a fascinating place to be here as all those questions are coming up. And I'm just as it's going to be fun to follow the innovations that come along being connected with GrayHawk and the companies that you're working with.
Yeah.
So you guys have been doing this for a while. How's it been going? What's the history look like of the last 20 years or so of GrayHawk?
Well, certainly we've been, I think this current environment has been strong. I don't know, you know, how long it'll hold up necessarily. But we've also been, we've also seen the down cycles, you know. So over the 20 years, though, I think innovation certainly will continue from our standpoint. A lot of opportunities to look at. You know, software will continue to proliferate, expand. It's become more important than ever, I think, is what COVID-19 has shown. Because these companies, whether you're low tech or not, you need to be nimble. So
I think
we're excited.
One thing people are surprised when they, you know, start to look at GrayHawk closely is the fact that about 2/3 of our investments end up being financially successful. Now, financially successful in this case is a low bar, $1 more.
Yeah.
But
I'm with you.
Yeah, but in the venture capital industry, you typically find more like 25-30% of an investment make money, as opposed to our 60-70%, and you know, we really like to think that that's because of a very thorough due diligence process that over 25 years, as I said, we've, you know, refined. And, you know, if you make a mistake, you change the process so you don't repeat that mistake in the future. And I think that's one of the things we're most proud of, is that we have a pretty low failure rate for a venture capital fund that's aiming for home run investments.
That is definitely something to be proud of.
I mean, we do have a lot of scars.
That's something to be proud of too, in a different way.
Yeah. All those scars.
We're still learning.
They're learning. That's a scar.
Always learning.
A scar is learning. You fell down, you scraped your knee. Let me at least make a new mistake the next time.
And we will.
So it's 20 years, and you're just on Fund 3 right now, and so, which is still, I'm an investor in Fund 3, and so that's not a whole lot of change over time. And it is. It's 20 years and a lot of success. Fund 3 is coming to a close, I guess, as the raise. And how many investments are there in Fund 3 that you've made so far?
Yeah, so far we've made 2 investments in Fund 3.
Okay.
They were smaller checks just because of where we were in the fundraising process, but we're about to move into kind of a full capacity mode here.
Yeah.
I don't know if we mentioned, but typically a full fund would be somewhere around 15 or 16 investments that we'll make in a single fund.
15 or 16, okay.
Yeah.
Part of that's, again, one of the learnings over time. Part of that's by design, because we do take board seats. We're active with the boards of our portfolio companies, and we don't really want any partner to have more than five boards at any one point in time. Yeah. That just starts stretching your bandwidth.
Kind of ties into an earlier topic we were talking about with the Arizona Tech Investors. Is Kyle and I are also investors in Arizona Tech Investors, and a group for Arizona Tech and ATI is going to be a part of the GrayHawk Hawk Fund coming together.
Very excited about that.
Yeah. Oh, so it's as this ecosystem is evolving, and it's just kind of fun to watch as it becomes more solidified here in Arizona.
We've known that group well and know Jim Gulka, who's headed it up well, and had a close working relationship with Jim through a number of those activities we were mentioning earlier. So we're delighted to have ATI on board.
Yeah.
Does GrayHawk at any point, like, what does the vision look like? We want to keep doing what we've been doing for 20 plus years and doing it better than we did it the day before and learning from the scars. Or is there, you know, is there this grand vision that's different from what it is today?
Love to keep doing it, but we all have to retire at some point in time. But, you know, we spent many years building the company. Certainly like to, you know, continue the business forward and the brand. So we have brought on recently a Label L. You know, he could play a pretty significant role in the future of GrayHawk as we think about succession planning and such. But we do want the GrayHawk brand to continue.
Is the work that Lab's doing, the Israeli companies, and is just the tie-in with that, is that outside of GrayHawk? Is that something that, hey, we've got a resource here inside of GrayHawk that we can really open ourselves up to this, to new markets and technologies?
Yeah, we should clarify that Label. Yeah, was brought on to help us with this Israeli strategy. This is a new strategy. It's an incremental to our current deal flow. We started looking at Israel market because we had some exposure in Fund 2 and actually in Fund 3 now. Two companies with the Israeli DNA, and we liked what we saw. And what we, as we looked into the Israeli market, what we found was that these companies have a lot of characteristics that we seek out in these underserved markets outside of Silicon Valley here in the U.S. as well. For example, they've been able to bootstrap longer. So when they get to a Series A round, they have pretty good traction. They're also very strong in certain themes like healthcare IT, fintech, cybersecurity, which also overlaps with GrayHawk's strategy very well. But we are not looking to invest into Arizona per se. We're looking to invest in these companies that are looking to come over into the U.S. and or have already come into the U.S. and we can help them.
You said Arizona, but you meant Israel. We're not investing in Israel.
Oh, sorry. We're definitely investing in Arizona.
Yeah.
We're not investing in Israel. We really don't have the bandwidth to do due diligence over there.
These companies probably started in Israel, spent some time in Israel, and have now become U.S. companies, and we're trying to identify the best and brightest of those early on.
And it's really Labe that's doing that for us. You know, he does have an outside organization that he started called the Arizona-Israel Tech Alliance. And their mission is to recruit companies from Israel into Arizona specifically. And he's been instrumental in recruiting like a dozen or so companies over the last 3 years. So he has a good network over there. And that's what we're looking for from Labe initially.
This is beyond Labe as well. I mean, this is the Governor Ducey, the state of Arizona, Arizona yep. Commerce Authority are also very tied in. And I think they've seen Israel startup state or startup, whatever they call
it. Well, Labe was, yeah, responsible for actually so a lot of that.
Okay. So it's an initiative. We're both desert climates and some similarities.
Absolutely.
So, yeah, that's been interesting to watch. It was Labe that actually brought me into GrayHawk. I'd known of GrayHawk for many years, but it was Labe. I met him through Conscious Capitalism, actually. And fun connections.
So somehow we've been talking for almost an hour. We're almost out of time, but I want to make time for a couple more questions here. One of them I always ask to anybody that's on the show, and it has nothing to do with anything we've been talking about. I'm just curious about it. And so I'm going to throw you a curveball here. And we're keeping track of these answers and we'll do something with them eventually, but not sure what yet. So the question, and for all three of you, and let's go around the same direction as last time as the first question, what is your favorite book of all time?
I don't read a whole lot, but the last book I thought that really made an impression on me was a book called Endurance. It's about the journey, a real journey, true life story of a ship captain explorer named Michael Shackleton, I believe it was. The name of his ship was Endurance. It was making a trip. I forgot what year this was, but it was back in the old days, wooden ship. And they made a trek to Antarctica, got trapped, ice crushed the ship, and they had to find their way back home from there, which was incredible. It was written in a log form, which you think would be quite dry and boring, but it was quite a page-turner. And really, really kept me engaged. But the story is amazing, and it's I guess poetic that the ship was named Endurance, and that was a whole. That's exactly what they had to go through to get to safety again, where no one died actually.
Wow!
After several months of being stranded.
You see some analogies to these startup entrepreneurs.
Yeah, it is.
Great, thank
it's
you.
Important.
Right.
And I, too, with the amount of reading we do for research and stuff, I'm a little embarrassed to say I don't do a whole lot of recreational reading now. But I would go back to the time I was 12 and I broke my leg one summer and read all the Tolkien books, and you can imagine, you know, no computer, no internet, three channels on the TV. I pretty much read all day and got through all of it. And
it's been that long since you read a book?
No, I have read one since then, but that probably sticks out the most.
Our other partner, Brian Smith, is a reader in the group. He's a history buff, but that's a good question for him, actually.
All of these are good answers, and I'd ask you too, but I mean, if nothing else, this is building a library, a backlog of books I've got to read at some point.
You know, I'm an avid reader, and I read business books, and that's learning. And I'm a constant learner, and I read Tolkien and all that, and that's my sort of relaxation. The most life changing book was probably Atlas Shrugged, and so brand myself here. I'm not a political libertarian; I'm a philosophical libertarian, and there's a lot that could be debated there. But just from just as we talk about capitalism, the economy, investment, and all of that, and just one of the more life changing books. That I've read, and it's a story, but there's a lot of philosophy from Ayn Rand in that story.
Are you a Rush fan too?
Yep. 80% level. I don't agree. I'm a philosophical libertarian, probably 80%, and I'm whatever, and it's nobody 100%. Sure, yes.
Great.
Apologies to anybody I've upset with that. No apology.
No, I'm sorry, Scott. I didn't mean Rush Limbaugh. I meant the band Rush, who is a big Ayn Rand source of their music. Sorry, I didn't mean to get political. We're going to have to delete that part.
No, we won't. And the answer is yes on all counts.
I love the answer.
That was a curveball.
Kyle, your book.
So, I listen to a lot of books and I read, and I You know, my favorite book of all time, it's not a business book, and it's a Stephen King book. And it's if it's not the Dark Tower series, it's it. And it's just, I've read every single one of his books that's not a novella, the longer books. And I say this and people laugh all the time, but I'm not joking. I learn almost as much about business by reading books like that and just thinking about, oh, what would I do? Or what would someone do? And just reading books like that then, hey, here's a tactical book about something I need to learn about. And so, hey, no apologies here either. Stephen King books.
Probably more interesting too.
So last question, any last things you want to say about GrayHawk to let any of the listeners know and let anybody know that's listening? How do we find you? Website or email, anything you want to get out there?
Yeah, our website is www.grayhawkcapital.us. You can also find us on LinkedIn and the other social media channels as well. We're fairly easy to get a hold of. We're based in the industrial space, co-working space there, as you know, in Drinkwater Boulevard, Old Town Scottsdale.
Because you live closer there. You would be at Back 6 otherwise, I'm sure.
Yeah, I guess I was responsible for finding the spot.
Great. So thank you to my co-host for the show, Scott McIntosh, and for Sherman Chu and Brian Burns for being on the show today. Until next time, we are off to continue building better communities where people and businesses thrive.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you for listening to the Future of Work Water Cooler Conversations with your hosts, Jen Burwell and Kyle McIntosh. Each episode shines the spotlight on business leaders who are defining what a healthy and productive workplace looks like in Arizona and beyond. To be part of the conversation, schedule a visit of the MAC 6 Entrepreneurial Center in Tempe, Arizona, and connect with us at max6.com. Remember to like and subscribe to the Future of Work Water Cooler Conversations on Apple Podcasts.